Hi guys, this is a video that was suggested by Mr. Random Art, and in this video I will teach you how to paint and shade with watercolors. For this tutorial I'll only be using the cube watercolor paints, which look like this. Mine is a very old set and a very messy one. You can see I put it to some good use. But I wanted to also use this video to show you other watercolor materials, because most people mistake the watercolors that they only come in cubes like this, a little dried out squares that you wet with a brush and pick up the color from it. That's not all you can get from the watercolor range. You can also, and this is what most professional watercolors use, get watercolors in tubes. Basically, not maybe so much with this cam, because this is a cheap watercolor tubes type, but if you buy some of these watercolor in tubes from something like Winsor & Newton, they can get quite expensive. You can pay up to £5, that's around $7 I believe, for one tube of paint if you get the high quality ones. However, I believe that Reeves watercolor, if you can get it locally, it's pretty good. And if you have to order online and you want to save some money, then the Winsor & Newton Cotman range is rather cheap and still of very high quality if you are planning to go on tubes. However, I would not suggest using these until you practice some watercolor paintings and until you're pretty comfortable with paint and you know how much you use, because you can easily waste a lot of this paint and not use any of it if you don't know how to measure out how much you use quite correctly. And also for the very beginners, there is this watercolor pencils, and I also got just a cheap set from WH Smith, that's a local bookstore here in England, and you get quite a few colors. I've got the biggest set they did, the 36 colors, and this I would suggest for anyone that's just starting out and you want to simply practice your tone and practice your shades, something like that. You get quite similar to skin tone colors, but what I would suggest is not use this pencil here. I would try and mostly use the orange pencil for your skin tone, mainly because in most cases you're going to actually be using orange paint to do your skin tone, because the most important thing is in watercolor is to understand how transparent your colors are and how you're going to be using the white of the paper to create the illusion. So I'm going to stop now, and I'm going to put the drawing in front that I prepared for this video, and I'm going to start talking to you about techniques that I use while painting my pictures. Okay, so I've got my picture, my line art, the ink is dry, the pencil is rubbed out. So these are my colors, this is the watercolors I'm going to be using for today. This is the palette that comes with the package for these watercolors, but I'm also going to be using this extra palette that I've got here. And these are dried up blobs of the watercolor that I showed you before. This one's right here. Okay, so those are my palettes. This is my picture. Now for the paint brushes. For the super big areas, I usually use this flat brush. It's a number 12 brush. It's just normally synthetic hair, nothing expensive, just a cheap brush. I don't use any expensive brushes. This is another brush I used. This was actually a round brush, which I cut off the edge for, and that I use for mostly painting trees, and it gives you a nice effect. But for this video, I'm mostly going to stick to just a simple round brush, and that's what you're mostly going to use in your watercolor paintings. They come in a variety of sizes, from size 10 to size 6, which is mostly common use, and size 2 for the small details. Size 2 brush also, I will say, that are mostly used for inking. Okay, so got my brushes, got my paint. All you need is a pot of water, and I would suggest changing your water every 20 to 30 minutes or so, so that it doesn't get too muddy and ruin your picture. Okay, let's get started with the painting. Okay, so I've got my water. I cleaned up my palette with a bit of tissue, and that's the only way you can clean this non-detachable from the paint types. The different type of palette, like this one, you can just run under a tap. Okay, we're gonna start with skin tone, because this is the only thing that I can teach you in this video, how to get the color right for it. Leonardo has a bit of a tan skin tone, so what we're gonna do is we're gonna get some of the darker yellow. This is called the cadmium yellow. Mix a nice light mixture of that in here. Add some cadmium or pretty much any red into this. Mix it a bit for the orange color, and then we're gonna grab some violety pink just to add that pinkish tone. And now what we're gonna do is just keep adding water into it until we're happy with the consistency. And you see I drew this line here. I'm gonna use everything below that line as my swatch, like a bit of test paper. So I'm gonna run the brush through. You'll see there's quite a nice skin color, you know, just one swoosh gives you nice patch, and depending on how much you put on, you're gonna get the skin tone lighter, darker, and you know, you can always, if you want, you can run over it a bit to add a bit more, or run your brush on the side like this and pick up a bit to make it less vibrant, or you can even grab a piece of tissue or toilet paper or something and dab it off if the color is too dark. Okay, so I'm happy with this color right now. So I'm gonna fill up my brush again, and this is probably the best advice I can give you. Practice, practice, and practice again until you're so comfortable with your painting skills that you can paint with any size brush, even a size 10 brush on this sort of a picture, and you can get all the details, and you will know that you're not running out of lines. And the most important thing to learn to do to be able to achieve that kind of level of skill is loading your brush. Because when you load your brush, you need to know how much water there's on a brush and how much water is coming off the brush at any time when you paint. So you can see I'm going kind of slow right now because I'm trying not to hold my brush at the very tip as I usually do. I'm trying to hold it further down so you can see what's happening. And as you can see, the more comfortable you are with the brush, you don't need to twist and turn the paper. The brush is the extension of your arm, you color where you want. Yeah? It takes a bit of practice, but it's a skill well worth having, because watercolors are one of the fastest mediums to use to paint your pictures. Definitely faster than Copic markers or acrylics or oils. And you can definitely develop more of your own style using watercolors than if you're using Copics. Okay, I'm gonna do the rest of this flat color areas in time lapse, and then I'm gonna move on to shading. Okay, so I finished with the flat colors, and now I'm gonna move into shading the figure. With watercolors, just as with Copic markers, you can almost every single time, not always, not with super dark colors, but you can use the same color used for the base, you can use for your first layer of shading. And right, now for the tricky bit. The way I shade is I create a cell shade first. This cell shading is hard edge shading, and then I go in with the brush again and I'll water it down and smooth the shading out, as you can probably see in my videos and by applying a lot of layers onto my pictures, I create this very muddy, greyish effect. And what I also do to do that is I try to keep my color palette as small as possible. And you will see this by using very similar colors for the skin, very similar color for my trousers, my shirt. They're all earthy colors, and I always try to keep in this theme of earthy colors, and that gives my pictures unity. Or at least that's the aim behind when I paint my pictures. Not to say that, you know, I don't make mistakes from time to time, or actually quite often. Anyways, besides the point. As you can probably notice, I also made a mistake while I was inking, and I did his hair. Ink that was water soluble, so I get this little spills. I'm gonna try and cover that up best I can with something like the shading. Okay, once again, I'm not gonna use this arm as a shader. I think it's gonna be much more interesting to show you how I shade this shirt in real time. So, get the same color, and because this is such a light mixture of color, I'm gonna grab some of this color for the belt, mix it into this, get some more of that sap green, get some of the more vibrant green in there. Mix a very similar color, and now you notice I'm mixing this color into the base color, so the base color is still there, I'm just deepening it, deepening the color, changing its hue. I'm not changing the color itself, I'm just changing its deepness and its hue by adding more colors into it. And that's the thing about watercolors, I literally have just a couple, about 12, 14 colors here. I'm not even 15, I'll say, because you don't even count the white, because you don't use that. And that's all I need for a whole painting with a whole variety of colors and a whole variety of hues. And this only costs, this little set Winsor & Newton only costs about £20. So, you know, comparing that to how much you spend on Copic markers, I think for a beginning artist, it's a no-brainer which choice it's better for you to learn how to shade. And obviously then, of course, if you have the wish, you're more than welcome to move on to Copic markers, and you're gonna have the skills you need with Copic markers after you learn how to paint with watercolors, because obviously you paint it with a brush, and Copic markers mostly have that brush-like nib to give the artist a feel, because that's what people learn to paint like with brushes. So it's more natural for them, for the Japanese artist, to paint with a brush nib. That's why Copic have those nibs. You can see the shading isn't exactly perfect or anything, it's just a roughening in of where some darkness goes, you know. And obviously this area would be a bit more covered. Yeah, but it wouldn't have a hard, this area definitely wouldn't have a hard edge. This is going to be one of the areas that I'm going to come back into to give it a softer edge. So, some edges you want to leave hard, because it makes it more realistic when you have the mixture of the hard and the soft edges. Makes the picture look more believable. And there's also going to be some shading here, because I have the lights just coming from this area, from the upper left, so all the shadows gonna fall on the lower right, and I personally believe that's the best place to put your light source, just for practice. Learn how to do that, and after you're comfortable, then move on to other you know, places to put your light source and stuff like that. Okay, so I'm gonna water down this shade color a bit more to get a lighter shade of it. And I'm gonna place it over, smoothing this out a bit. And then I'm gonna just clean out my brush, and just with the brush itself, dry it out a bit. I'm gonna just go under the circles, just as if you were doing with Copic markers. You go under the circles and you shade that thing in. The only difference between this and Copic is that with Copic you have a certain amount of time, and if you run out of that time for the before the color dries, you're screwed. And with watercolors, you just, let's say this area already dried, I just wet my brush a tiny bit, I can go back in, add the wetness to it and pick up the color again, and I can lessen it, I can pick some of the color back up if I wanted to, I can smooth the color out, you know, cover up a bit of my mistakes, stuff like that. It's a very forgiving medium, watercolors, very forgiving. That's why it's so good for beginners, and that's why I keep using it, because I'm not a saint and I make a lot of mistakes when I paint, so watercolor is my best friend for an artist like me, for a beginner that just is still learning, you know, how the shadow falls, where the shadow falls, you know, the nature of the shadow, because you really have to think of the shadow as a living thing. It's like a creeping creature that goes everywhere where the light doesn't reach, and it's not as, and also you have to not think of it as a solid mass, not unless you want to do cell shading, that's a complete different story. Okay, so you know, you see pretty smoothed out, quite colors laid on it, and that would be this for the shading. Okay, this video is getting kind of long, so I'm gonna once again click it into time lapse and shade all the rest of it, and come back to show you how I add textures and model up the picture. Yeah, okay, so I finished the shading, and as you probably noticed, except for the shirt which I did in real time, while I was shading, I modded up most of my picture, and the way I do it is basically, as you see, I have my three colors that I used for this picture, and that's what I stuck to. I didn't add anything else to it, I just stay with my color palette. And by adding all these colors with each other, I created this effect of muddiness that brings this whole picture together. The only standout color that we've got in this picture is what I'm doing right now on the buckle, this rusty color. And I'm just adding some dark lines to it to give it a metallic feel. And then I'm gonna take some lines away with some water. At least I'll try. If that doesn't work out, you know, I can always come back with some white ink or something like that to finish it off. You know, give it that deepness that I need, like in the rest of the picture. Just adding last touches to the forehead because I didn't shade the forehead here. Hopefully. Okay, so basically, to sum up everything I did in this video, start with flat colors, then pick out the with the cell shading, pick out the general area of shadow, and then smooth it out with some water using the wet on wet technique. Or if you wish, you can be more careful with the areas you shall select. Use a lighter color to start with, let it dry completely, and then add layers and layers and layers. If you would like me to do a video showing you that particular technique of watercolor, which I would be more than happy to do for you guys, please leave a comment saying so, and I'll see what I can do. For now, this is it guys, thank you for watching, please comment, rate and subscribe. See ya!